Hiya, BookTube. I'm Roz, and this is the second part of my answers to the questions. I never thought I would make a two-part video for this, but apparently I like to talk, and you guys asked some really good questions. So I'm continuing this in the second part here. I hope you enjoy it. Okay, so Joe Smith says, ooh, my brain is working. I thought I could smell something. What are those other things you mentioned you do for fun? And also, did you always want to be a teacher and why? And if not, how did you end up as one? So I hope you took that as a joke. That was meant as a joke. Things that I do for fun. Well, back in the day where I had time, I enjoy crocheting, knitting, painting, drawing. Okay, both of those portraits. I'm trying, well, last holiday I tried to get into doing landscaping. But you see, the thing with portraits is that you need to be so particularly fussy with detail, because otherwise it doesn't look like the person. And landscapes, you need to make it look like you were fussy about detail, but actually not be. So I'm struggling to get that combination right. So I love doing portraits. And with drawing, I love charcoal, even though it's a horribly unforgiving medium. I also used to enjoy gardening. I had this glorious veggie garden, but we have a drought, and so I can't water anything. And then, did I always want to be a teacher? That's a tricky one to answer. No, I didn't want to be a teacher. Yes, I knew I was good at teaching, but not my direct family, so not my mom and dad, but, you know, uncles, people like that, said things like, you know, those who can't do, like, those who can do, those who can't teach. And yeah, that's the biggest load of BS going, but you know, that line actually really stuck with me, and I felt that if I settled for becoming a teacher, I was settling for the fact that I actually wasn't capable of doing it myself, that I was only able to give other people guidance on how to do it. But you know, anybody who thinks that about teaching really doesn't understand teaching. I mean, we are parents, we are psychologists, we are bodyguards and bouncers, we are event organizers, we are medics, we are sports management teams, we are, you name it, we do it. And graphic designers even. I mean, last year I was doing all the book covers, I made some books even for the school, adverts, posters, you name it. I mean, we do this stuff, and it's not like we have degrees in it, but you'd be surprised on the quality that teachers can actually pull out. I mean, computer specialists, I mean, we can use pretty much any program going, you know, normal office program, and extras, I mean, movie editors, you name it, we can do it. You'd be surprised what teachers can do, and we do. It's just, we have a special skill, well, at least those are good at it, in relaying information as well, and being super, super patient. Patience. Yeah. Those who teach have patience. Okay, I think that was it. How did I end up as one? I ended up in South Korea, as I said, and I realized that I should actually just be in teaching, and sucked it up, and then went back to varsity at the age of 30. Well, it was the year I turned 30. And did my postgraduate certificate in education, got distinctions, and it's what a difference it is when you're paying for it yourself, hey, and you actually put in the effort. And then went back to South Korea afterwards, did another year of teaching, and then came back to South Africa, and yeah, that is how I got into teaching. Okay, Seriella, I hope I've said that right. Welcome. I don't think I've read any comments by you before either. Welcome to my challenge, my channel. I love hearing from new people. Anyway, she says, I'm always interested in how children around the world acquire an interest in and the habits of reading. How is that process for you? That is such an important question. I mean, we are all readers. I suppose we take it for granted, but especially from an educator's point of view, where especially in this country, reading is something that does not happen. And it is a question that I've been pondering, and I know what my answer is, and I think I know what the answer is to get kids to read. So I'm going to share mine, and that was one, I have always been surrounded by books. As a child, there were books. You can even see that I mutilated some of them with crayon. much to my mom's horror, I think. I have a picture of me at the age of two going through an alphabet book with my gran. I will pop it up there if I remember. And if I have electricity in which to edit this. And I was also surrounded by people who read. So it wasn't this foreign thing that I was, and this unusual thing that I was being made to do. It was just something that normal people did. People watched the news, people read books, people cooked food, you know. So this is what I learned how to do. And then on top of it, my mom used to read to my brother and I in bed every night. And I think that is actually what was the final catch. I mean, everything in this worked together. I think it was important that I was surrounded by books. I think it was super important that I saw people reading. But it's also given me that love of a story before I go to bed at night. And even as an adult, whether I'm reading a set work book for school or whether I am reading for fun or for information, I still read before I go to sleep at night. Before my eyelids close, I have read something, even if it's just a couple of pages. But I can't just go to bed. I have to read first. And I think that is what happened in my process. So Tilly Trout says, I have a couple of questions. Hello, Tilly. I think you're also new here. Welcome to my channel. I love getting new comments. And she says, oh, this was the difficult question. This was the one that I scratched my brains over for a couple of days. And she says, what are your top five books that you would want to read again and again as an adult? If you had to recommend a good holiday read that is also not too light, what would you suggest? And what are your favorite series? I'm always looking for those. Aren't we all? Phew. So you really made me scratch my brains, because top five books, I've read thousands of books, my top five books. So I'm choosing from me at the moment, and I'm choosing books that have stuck with me the longest, for good or for bad. And the first one I'm going to say is We Need to Talk About Kevin. That book, although I do genuinely consider it the closest thing that I have read to a scary, scary book, has really stuck with me. I thought Lionel Shriver put it together fabulously. While you knew what happened, you did not know exactly how it happened and what exactly had happened. And I thought that was brilliant. And also because it's to do with education and a child that went to school. It's written by the mother of a kid who went to school and killed other children. I mean, that's just terrifying on my level as a teacher, and I must admit it must be horribly terrifying for a parent as well, either on the victim or the perpetrator's point of view. Wolf Hall, I loved Wolf Hall. It was my favorite book of last year, and I would love to reread Wolf Hall again. I just fell in love with Hilary Mantel's Thomas Cromwell. Sure, I almost went blank there. Remains of the Day by Kazuo Ishiguro. That's my favorite book by him, and I would really like to read that one again. I think I could get even more out from a further reading. The Crimson Petal and the White by Michelle Faber. I really, really enjoyed that. It's set in the Dickensian time. Oh, how's that for a horrible use of language? It's set in the Victorian time, and you can smell London in those, and I think he did a fabulous job without, he didn't settle for that nice, polished, sweet Dickens look at the times. He was pretty crude and rough, and I really enjoyed it. And then possibly anything by Jane Austen. So those are possibly my top five books. At the moment, you know, these things change. If I had to recommend a holiday read that's not too light, one that is a little bit possibly not very heavy, but not necessarily the lightest, would be Big Little Lies. But I suppose everybody here has read that or else seen it. I haven't seen it yet. And then Wolf Hall. I thought that was brilliant. And I also put here The Power of One. And I always have odd feelings when I put down The Power of One. The Power of One was my favorite book ever for many, 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 many years, probably about a decade. And the only reason why I'm a bit iffy suggesting it nowadays is because it's been about 10 years since I read it last. I mean, in the years before then, I probably read it about 40 times, because I used to read it pretty much finish and then start again. That was in the days before I had a salary. I couldn't buy books. I used to reread my favorite one. And I don't know what I would think of it now, but I know that 10 years ago I thought it was a very realistic depiction of South Africa and that it had some really, really wonderful characters. It's a book that really contains cruelty but love. And I'm not meaning boyfriend, girlfriend, you know, that kind of love, platonic love between friends and a mentor and a student. And I really, really was touched by that book years ago. It covers harsher topics. I mean, South Africa has a past that it's not very proud of. So, you know, all of that is in there. It's hard to miss it. So, but I don't know what I would think of it now as 41-year-old almost me. So just not 100% sure whether I would or wouldn't recommend it. And then the last one, my favorite series, well, that one, anybody who's been watching my channel for a while will know that it's the Matthew Shardlake series by CJ Sanson. I've also put, I don't really read that much series at the moment. And the series that I used to read was generally crime. I probably still can say that I pick up crime series or fantasy series. Fantasy generally because it's very difficult to find fantasy that is not in a series. And as far as that goes, I really enjoy Brandon Sanderson's style, Stormlight Archives, and I really enjoyed both books by Brent Weeks, which was the Lightbringer series, both books, both series, and the, oh good Lord, what was the other one? It's the other one. He's only written two. I can't read it from here. It's the one that's got shadow in the titles. That series. I really enjoyed them. But I enjoy those more as lighter reads. Crime series, I can't really recommend crime series. I mean, I really enjoyed some things of the Kathy Reich's crime novels, but you get those books, some books that are fabulous, and you get others that are very far from it. So I wouldn't know how to recommend. And then another series that I do kind of enjoy is the Number One Ladies Detective Agency by Alexander McCall Smith. It's a series set in Botswana, and this series I feel has done a misjustice, well, an injustice, because it is often marketed as crime fiction, and it's not. It is actually just a depiction of very honest people in living a very simple, innocent life in Botswana. And I actually really appreciate it for that. So that's just another series that I do enjoy. But as I said, you can't go into that thinking that you're going to get a crime novel. What is also nice with it is that they're very short. They're very quick to read, and the characters in it are pretty awesome. They really stick with you. I mean, even to the lady who runs the orphanage. I mean, you can't forget her and what she manages to accomplish. Okay, Erica Thompson says, you mentioned in a video last week how expensive books are in South Africa. I was wondering what the average price for paperbacks and hardbacks are. Also, how are the bookshops in South Africa? Thanks. Hi, Erica. Thanks for the question. Okay, so your average paperback here goes for approximately 350 rand, which putting it into US dollars is $25 or £20. Hardbacks are starting at about 500 starting off, which is $35 to £25. So that alone, I think, is a little bit more expensive than what you get. The next thing to consider, though, is that most South Africans earn less than 10,000 rand. So if a book is costing about 500 rand and you're only earning 10,000, that is a rather ridiculous percentage to pay for a book. I know that here they put up import tax on books, which seems crazy considering one of our biggest problems in this country is illiteracy. And they literally have priced it out of most people's range, especially when it comes to the people who need it. And as I said, you know, if most people earn less than 10,000 and they still got to cover housing and they still got to cover food and clothing and all the other expenses that one accrues in a month, I mean, what they're earning is not even enough to cover the expenses, let alone have luxuries like books. And I feel it's horrible the fact that I have to label a book as a luxury item, but unfortunately there are necessities which do need to come first. I also should possibly add that this is pretty much starting prices in your average bookshop. I know that when I was looking for A Long Walk to Freedom, it was 800 Rand, which was almost 10% of my salary at that point in time. And I thought that was ridiculous. I was not going to pay that much for a book. That is the reason why I like my favorite bookshop. It's the only bookshop where you can buy brand new books at discount prices. You will notice that I always read behind the times, approximately 2 years behind. And the reason being is that not your popular books generally, but your Man Booker Prize winners, etc. Within 2 years, they end up in the bargain section, so I can then buy three books for the 450 Rand if they're in mass market, or three books for 200 Rand if they're in trades. And that is much more reasonable than the other prices if I went to other bookshops. They do have the new releases at those prices, but they are still generally more reasonable than other places. So I am very fond of them because I get to read the kind of books that I like at a price that is a little bit more reasonable, in my opinion. The only thing is you have to wait. So I would rather wait because I can get more books that way. And it also eliminates a lot to do, well, a lot of the issue where you don't know if you really like the book or whether it's the hype that you were hearing at that time, because I must admit I've been very disappointed as a result of hype in the past. Talking about bookshops, our bookshops here are generally a lot smaller than bookshops overseas. There was nothing quite that blew my mind than Guangdong Moon. Was it Guangdong Moon? No, Kyobo Bookstore. Kyobo Bookstore in Korea at Guangdong Moon Station. And that place was the size of a shopping center, and it was just a bookshop. The English section alone was larger than any bookshop that I've seen in South Africa. And I was so blown away. The same thing in England when I went there. I was so tempted to throw out all my clothes and just come home with books, except I wasn't going home. I was going back to Korea. And I knew that I then had to then get all of these books home. So I restrained the urge, not because I wanted to. I still regret the fact that I didn't get the complete Sherlock Holmes. It was gold leaf. Oh, it was beautiful. It really was. I still regret not buying that though. It was, oh, beautiful. So yeah, so, but also the stock in South African bookshops is not the same as it is overseas. You get a lot, a wider variety overseas. Whereas here, because there are fewer people who read, I'm not going to say nobody reads, but it's not as popular as it is. I think booksellers, for the sake of keeping businesses running, only really get books that are guaranteed to sell. So you can get the popular books, but to get something that is more obscure, they actually need to order it in for you. So that also then costs, obviously, but if you really want to read it that badly, that's what we do. Okay, so I hope I've answered your questions. Rashmika likes books, says, you're a lot more interesting than you give yourself credit, Roz. Thanks. You said in one of your videos that you used to have aspirations to be a novelist. What's changed? Has life simply got in the way, or have you decided that writing isn't something you want to pursue at all? Yeah, I have dreamed of being a novelist since I was 5. As I said, I grew up surrounded by books. And I've always wanted to write books. And I've got stories that were written over 3 lines when we were still learning uppercase, well, the upper section, the middle, and the lowercase sections for lettering. But unfortunately, it's a combination between life's got in the way. I really do have a rather packed schedule. And when I don't have a rather packed schedule, I must admit that I feel wrung out. I don't have the creative energy to try and be creative. What I do at school is mark essays. Well, I mean, I teach, but if I have a moment, I'm marking and I'm sitting correcting people's grammar and language, and To sit down and do that, I've written a trilogy which I just need to edit really and rewrite the ending because I don't like it. But I'm also a bit sick and tired of the story because I spent so many years working on it, which sounds stupid considering I spent so many years working on it, but I'm just over it now. But I think it's just, I don't have much left in me. I just want to relax. I want to be able to sit and read and take in the creativity rather than try and put out more. I must admit it was very difficult. Last year was, no, it was the year before, it was the first year that I didn't write Nano. Last year was the second. And it was a very difficult decision because I've done Nano for about 10 years in a row. I've had Nanos where I've done brilliantly. I wrote 154,000 words plus tax. But yeah, it's the only thing that Stephen King said in On Writing that made sense, and that was when he spoke about writing when you're a teacher. And I don't know if his workload was quite the same as my workload, especially starting again with a whole new set of literature and the requirements of that. So I don't know, we'll see. It's not a dream that I've given up on, which actually is heading on to Vera for the love of words. So I'm going to move on to her question here. She says, yes, I'm a bit late to the party, but that was the question I was going to ask that was commenting on Rashmika's. And she says, are you still writing just for the fun of it? And no, not unless you count setting exam papers, making study guides, worksheets, etc. I suppose it's technical writing, but and writing other things that teachers write, like report comments and reports and all the other kind of things. No, I'm not writing at the moment. I know the idea out there is that you can make time, but one also needs to make time for themselves. And I think if I had to push that out of me too, I would crash and burn a lot faster than I am already. And as I said, burnout is knocking on this door already, and it's only February, and I've got to make it through to the beginning of December before I finally can get to call a break or a decent break. So I'm not writing at the moment. It's not something I've given up on. I would like to sit down and actually do something, but I think the other thing is that I have changed a lot since I started writing. Especially the trilogy that I wrote, and I mean, I don't enjoy reading YA anymore, and the fact that I wrote YA is, while I enjoyed it at the time, it's not something that appeals to me at the moment, so I'm not feeling as connected with the story. And then I'm also, I don't know what I would write now. If I'm not working on that, I mean, I wrote a fantasy the 1 year for Nano, and I really liked the idea considering I had planned nothing. It was completely by the seat of my pants because I didn't have time to plan. I just wrote, and I enjoyed the way that came out. But, once again, there's nothing I can, I don't have the time to actually do anything. And anybody who tells me I can make the time does not understand my schedule. So, yeah, because I work until about midnight every day. I'm taking tonight off because I worked my entire weekend until midnight, both Saturday and Sunday. And I said to my mom tonight, I'm not doing schoolwork. I will wing it tomorrow and we will just make it work. So, Alan Morton says, hello, Roz. Hi, Alan. He says, racked brain for some intelligent, piercing, and fascinating questions failed. So instead, who is your favorite author and which author or authors do you have the most books by and why? And he says that he has W. Somerset Maugham and Anthony Trollope and 20 books, more than 20 books of each author there, and more than 40 books by an author by the name of Jean Plaidy. I'm actually curious. I've never heard of Jean Plaidy, Alan. You're going to have to tell me something about him or her. Is it Jean or Jean? And he puts his criteria for excellence as being excellent storytellers, creating fascinating characters, and having a pleasing style. And that's the combination he likes. So Oh, this is such a difficult question. I wrote this one down by hand because I've just seen it in the comments now. I don't know, as I said, power outages. I have not been at my computer to do anything remotely fun, like go anywhere near YouTube for over a week, so I missed this one. Let me start with the authors that I have the most books by. And this is not necessarily a reflection of who my favorite authors are, though. So I've got a huge pile of Lee Child, the Jack Reacher series, which I'm actually planning on selling off to my secondhand books shop dealer. And if he's not interested or is not prepared to give me a decent price for them, I will then maybe donate them off to the school that I'm at the moment. Other than that, I have almost all the Discworld series by Terry Pratchett, so that's quite a lot. I definitely have more than 20 books by Terry Pratchett. And then I think I have approximately 15, maybe a bit more, of Anthony Horowitz. So those would be the authors that I have the most books by, but they're not my favorite authors. I mean, Lee Child is definitely not my favorite author. He is my guilty pleasure. I need to remove my brain and relax, read. And actually, I'm not buying them anymore. I just get them as an audio, listen to it, and then delete it. So, yeah, he's definitely not a favorite author. I do enjoy Jack as a character, though, for a little while. Not even a whole book's worth, but for a bit, I enjoy Jack. The Anthony Horowitz books, I think I have everything age group wise from Alex Rider onwards, except for The Killing Joke, which was dreadful. I enjoy his Sherlock Holmes series that he did. I've now got the Agatha Christie, I think it is, that he's done. I haven't read them yet, but I'm looking forward to getting to that. And then the YA series that he's done, Alex Rider, which I absolutely love. Not because I think he's a fabulous writer, but because he managed to make me suspend reality and be a 14-year-old boy spy for a couple of hours, and I just love that. And I've managed to get so many young boys interested in reading with that series, so that's pretty awesome. And then Terry Pratchett, those books are beautiful. I'm not getting rid of them, I think they're gorgeous, and I enjoy them just for relaxation, so they're not my favorite writers. If I had to really think about my favorite writers, oh, it's such a difficult question because I find that, generally speaking, like, I loved Room by Emma Donoghue. I really, really loved it. But then I picked up The Sealed Envelope by her and I didn't even finish it. I just couldn't. There's so often that there's a writer that I really enjoy one book of, but I don't really enjoy more, others. I suppose that if I had to speak on my automatic buy writers, it would be Margaret Atwood. Up until recently, Isabel Allende, but I'm not writing her off as yet completely, and quite a lot of Amy Tan as well. I've also enjoyed what I've read of David Mitchell, and I'm looking forward to carrying on with him. And as far as classic writers go, I suppose that would be the safest area. Oh, I have a lot of Shakespeare. I don't know if I consider him my favorite. But I have a lot of Shakespeare. It's like I have six copies of Othello because they all have different notes in them and it helps. Three copies of Romeo and Juliet. I have at least four of Hamlet. You get the idea. So, especially if I've taught it, I have multiple copies, or else throughout the times I've found a nicer copy or a different edition of one and then I've bought it. So I have a massive Shakespeare section. But I would say, probably as far as classics go, that I really have enjoyed Jane Austen. I haven't read enough of the Brontes to make a fair judgment there. Who else would I consider an automatic buy as far as classics go? Oh, that's such a difficult question. This is such a difficult question. You see, you did manage to come to light with something that was fascinating and piercing. I'm feeling pretty pierced right now because I'm failing on the last question to come to light with a decent answer. Favorite authors. I mean, there's my fun favorite authors, where I'm not going to consider that they are necessarily my favorite author for writing, but like CJ Sanson, his setting there, the atmosphere is brilliant, and I love his characters that he's created. But necessarily, favorite author, I don't know. I mean, I've enjoyed a lot of Ali Smith that I've read, but then there's others that I thought were completely and utterly overrated. I didn't understand why there was so much hype, like The Accidental. I didn't see it. Whereas I really enjoyed How to Be Both. I need to try Anthony Trollope though, and W. Somerset Maugham. I think I have two books each by them. That's only 10% of yours, and I haven't read any, so that's not very good. I have quite a bit of Dickens as well, but I'm not too sure if I mean, there's some Dickens that I've really enjoyed, and there's some that I haven't enjoyed as much. But I really enjoyed A Tale of Two Cities, and I enjoyed Oliver Twist when I read him 20 years ago. So I don't know. There's just so many out there, and it's difficult to choose just an author because things can change over time as well. Okay, well, that was rather a deflated ending. Unfortunately, I'm really sorry. I should have given that one a bit more thought, but I saw the question just before I started filming. So, alas, you got the winged answer there. I know there's no such word in English. I keep telling people that this week. I winged it. I know there's no such word, but it's becoming one in my vocabulary. It's when you don't have time to prepare and you just do it on the fly. So, it's winging it. Anyway, that is the answers to my Q&A. I hope that you've learned something interesting. I hope that you enjoyed it. I hope you found it interesting. One of the above. I hope that I answered your questions as you wanted them, or as you hoped I would. And yeah, to the next idea for the next milestone. Anyway, that's me for now. Happy reading. Bye for now.